Queen Square, Bloomsbury, London. This is where Michael Banissy's office is at the Institute of Cognitive Neurosciences of the University College London. Dr. Banissy works on the phenomenon of synesthesia and social perception. Dr. Banissy talks about his research subject, what it is, and why he researches it. What is synesthesia?
Synesthesia, you can kind of think of it as a blending of the senses. And it refers to a condition where one property of a stimulus will evoke a secondary experience that's not typically associated with the first. So, for example, a particular letter may evoke a colour, or a particular name may evoke a taste, or observing somebody being touched might evoke an experience of touch on a sense of its own body.
What are examples?
Examples of this could include grapheme colour synesthesia, where letters evoke colours, or tone colour synesthesia, where particular tones or particular sounds, pieces of music, will evoke a perception of colour.
What is the strangest form?
Lots of people have different takes on what is the strangest form. Some people are quite often quite fascinated by words evoking tastes, so lexical gustatory synesthesia. There's been some quite famous cases of this. For example, the word Derek may taste of earwax or something like that. Or you might find people having conflicting tastes. For example, if they go to a restaurant, they're eating food, but there's lots of people talking around them. They're getting tastes from the sensory information that's coming in. So it can be quite a curious kind of experience for the synesthete.
Is it an illness?
It's not considered a clinical condition, synesthetes live naturally healthy lives. Most people aren't even aware they have synesthesia because they've had it from childhood. It's a developmental thing, although sometimes it does acquire after brain injury, but that's a slightly different case in perspective, really.
How do you research it?
We can design computer-based tasks that will test the person's synesthesia. So one example would be a synesthetic Stroop task. Now, people might be familiar with a Stroop from things like brain training games, so where you see a word presented in the wrong colour, so for example red presented in green text. We use variants of this with synesthetes. So what we all, in that situation for all of us, we're normally slower when there's a conflict between the actual name of the word and the colour of the word. With synesthetes, what we can do is we can actually present them, for example, a letter that's in the wrong colour to their synesthetic colour, or the same colour to their synesthetic colour. And what we see is that they perform again, they have this conflict between the two, and therefore they're slower when it's in the wrong colour than when it's in the right colour. So that's one way of kind of behaviourally showing they've got a conflict, because for everybody else, it doesn't really matter if A is red and B is green, for example. For the synesthete, it would matter.
What other research methods are there?
Moving away from the more behavioural level, we also have more kind of neurophysiological studies. So this will include tests such as functional brain imaging. What we can do is we can take synesthetes and we can put them in a brain scanner, and we can give them material that will evoke their synesthetic experience and see what's occurring in the brain. And we see a different pattern of activity in the synesthetes and the non-synesthetes. So in some cases you might find that a synesthete who experiences colour will evoke colour regions of the brain when hearing a word, which non-synesthetes wouldn't necessarily do.
Why, if it's not a condition, do you research it?
The idea is that potentially what you're seeing in synesthetes is a kind of neurodevelopmental difference. So as they're developing, their brains are developing slightly differently. And it can open up a number of interesting avenues for broader questions. So for example, these people have added conscious experiences, so you can think about using it as a model to study conscious perception. And understanding the mechanism of the brain that contribute to consciousness is a very kind of massive challenge, actually, in neuroscience and in science in general.
Do you want to know more about synesthesia, or do you think you might be a synesthete? Check out the links below for more information.